Welcome back again. Now, in this class, we are still going to look at the organic chemistry questions and answer. Now, you have the first question here. Now, characteristics of homologous series includes all except. Now, the homologous series are families of compounds in which every group different from the successive group by a CH2, by a CH2, or by methylene group. For instance, you have methane, CH4. You have ethane, CH26. Now, these two groups are in the same homologous series, which is the alkane series. Okay? You see that they are different from each other by CH2. If you C2 minus C here is C, then H6 minus H4 will give us what? H2. So, every member different from the successive. Now, all compounds in the same homologous series have the same general formula, and this general formula in most cases, most of them can be prepared by the same method. Are we getting it now? Can be prepared by this same method. Then the physical property changes regularly with increasing number of what? Carbon atoms. That is correct. So we have the options: A, members of the series can be represented with a formula. That is correct. All members of homologous series can be represented with a formula. The physical property changes regularly with increasing number of carbon atoms. That is correct. Now, members homologous series can be prepared using the same method. That is correct. They are all family, and hence, since they are family, they can be prepared by using the same method. Are we getting this now? Your families. I'm giving birth to you. You are a family. You let's say, okay, let me not go there. So they can be prepared by using the same method. Now, the members have different chemical properties. Do they? No. Members of the same homologous series have the same chemical properties. So that makes this one to be the answer, because we are looking for the one except. Are you getting it? So this one is the correct answer. All members have the same physical property, and the same chemical, they have the same chemical properties, and they have the same functional group. Okay, have the same chemical property, and they have the same functional group. So you saying that they have different functional group, it makes this answer to be wrong. The next one: the following class of hydrocarbons or compounds are classified as saturated hydrocarbons. Now, hydrocarbons are compounds that contains what? Carbon and what? Hydrogen only. Okay? Now, we have two types. We have the saturated hydrocarbon. We have the saturated hydrocarbon. And then we have the unsaturated hydrocarbon. We have the saturated and the unsaturated. All these ones, they are, this is not hydrocarbon to start with. So, this is wrong. This is hydrocarbon, but this is what? Unsaturated. Alkene is unsaturated. The unsaturated, we have alkenes and what? Alkynes. Okay, why the saturated? You have the alkenes. So the alkenes are the saturated hydrocarbon, and that means this to be the correct answer. Okay, now the next question. Nitrogen can be estimated by, the correct answer is the Jeddah method. Okay, Jeddah method. Nitrogen can be, this is the Jeddah equipment. It is used to estimate the presence of nitrogen in proteins. We said that proteins contains amino acids. Are we getting this now? An amino acid, they have the amino group and the what? The acid group. Okay, so if you want to, this is the simplest formula or the general formula of all amino acid. Okay, so if you want to estimate the presence of nitrogen in the particular protein, because proteins are, amino acids are present in proteins, and nitrogen is present in amino acid, so analyzing protein, you must definitely get what? Nitrogen. Okay, now the method that is used for that process is the Jeddah method, and this is the Jeddah equipment. The equipment that is used, Jeddah equipment. Okay, so this is the equipment you, and the method is the Jeddah method, can be used to estimate nitrogen. So that's the answer to that question. Now, The next question, which pairs of isomers are positional isomers? Now, what are positional isomers? Positional isomers are those isomers that differs in the position of the functional group. They are compounds with the same molecular formula, but differs in the position of the functional group. Now, if you look at this compound very well, are they positional isomer? They don't have the same molecular formula. One of the pointers to making them have the same molecular formula is that they must have the same number of atoms in them. Now, this one has how many carbon? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This one has how many carbon? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So they have 5 carbons, okay? But you see that this one is CO. If I want to break this down, okay, this becomes CH3, then we have CO, then you have O, CH2, CH2, CH3. That is this compound here. Then this one is CH3, CH2, then we have C double bond O, O, CH2, CH3. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They are the same, everything is the same, but they are not positional isomer. It only differs in the position of a substituent, not the functional group. Now, if you see these two compounds, they are not the same functional group. This is ether, and this is what? Alcohol. They are not the same functional group. Now, look at this. Of course, you know this one, they are not the same functional group, okay? Now, look at this. If you see this compound very well, how many carbons do you have here? 1, 2, 3. How many carbons here? 1, 2, 3. Now the substituent, which is the functional group here, is at what position? It's at position 1, OH. Why this one here is at position what? 2. If I want to draw this, it will be something like this. If I bring the two of them out, CH2, CH2, then this one is what? OH. Why the other one is CH3, CH, OH, CH3. So this is the positional isomer. Are we getting it now? This is the one that exhibits positional isomer. This particular one, I think it also does that, but then we have to take this one as our answer. The reason will be explained later. Maybe I didn't actually type this one. Maybe there's an error somewhere around, okay? So let's take note of that. Or let's count the hydrogen. How many hydrogens are here? These three hydrogen, 5, 7, 10. How many are here? This 5, still 10. Everything is the same, but maybe the typing is so. This one also undergoes positional isomer, but this is the correct answer you should choose when this question comes out. I don't know why, but this is the correct answer you should choose. Okay, yeah, that's the correct answer. Now, the next question, which is the correct order of acidity? Now, one thing that you must know is the higher the electronegativity, the higher the acidity, and the closer the atom is to the carboxylic group, also the higher the acidity. Are you getting it now? The presence of substituent. If the substituent is more electronegative, the higher the acidity, and the closer it is to the functional group also, the higher the acidity. So in this case, if you have, let's say, this CH2COOH, fluorine and chlorine, which is more electronegative, is fluorine. So whenever fluorine is present, fluorine is more what? Electronegative, and hence you have higher what? Acidity compared to chlorine. But when it is closer, the one that is closer is the one you take note of, to the what? To the COOH group. And also, if more than one is present, it also increases the what? The acidity. So you have the order. Now you have Cl2COO. This one is not correct. The reason why it is not correct is because if you look at this group very well, this Cl, there's a substituent here. Are you getting it? Here there is no substituent. The presence of substituent increases acidity. Hence, this one is supposed to be more acidic than what this. Are you getting it now? So this one cannot be correct because it says this is less than this. Are you getting it now? So we, like we said, the presence of what? The substituent increases the what? Acidity. Do we get it now? So that option A is not correct. Now look at option B. This one is having just the carboxylic acid, no substituent. This one is having one substituent. The substituent is chlorine. This one is having another substituent. Substituent is fluorine. You know fluorine is more electronegative than chlorine. Hence, chlorine will be less acidic than fluorine. So this order is actually correct. Okay, the order is correct because fluorine is more electronegative. So fluorine will have the highest acidity. So this one is one. This is correct. This one is two. This is correct. Then this one is three is correct. Fluorine is more electronegative, so the link is continuing. And then this one is what? Also correct. Why? Because we have two chlorine molecule. Like I said, the higher the number of chlorine molecule, the higher the acidity. The higher the number of chlorine molecule, the higher the acidity. Or the higher the number of halogens, the higher the acidity. It may be chlorine, it may be fluorine, but the higher the what? Acidity. So the number there is 2. What you have there is Cl2, COH, COOH. Do you get it now? So that makes this to be the correct answer to that question. If you look at this, this is even the more acidic here. Are you getting it? Fluorine is more acidic than chlorine. Are you getting it? So this is wrong. Then they say chlorine is less acidic than fluorine, which is less acidic than chlorine, which is less acidic than what this. This one is the least acidic among everything here. So the correct answer is option B. Let me state the fact again. Now, we said substituent increases acidity. Increases what? Acidity. And the higher the substituent present, the higher the acidity. The higher the electronegativity, rather, of the substituent present, the higher the acidity. Fluorine is more electronegative than chlorine. So if you see fluorine in the same carboxylic acid as chlorine, the fluorine will be more acidic than what? That of the chlorine. That was why we said this is more acidic. No, this is more acidic than this. Remember, the sign is less than. So this one, there's no substituent at all. So it is less acidic than anyone with a substituent. So this is less acidic than this. And this is less acidic than this. And this is less acidic than this because this one has a higher number of chlorine or the higher number of what? Halogen. Okay? That is that for this question. Now, which of the purification method is based on solubility? It's crystallization. Crystallization is based on solubility at different temperature. Crystallization is a separation technique that is based on solubility at different temperature. Okay? Now, the next question. The following reaction represents one what kind of reaction? The following is esterification. Now, esterification is a reaction whereby the carboxylic acid group reacts with the OH of alcohol to give an ester. Now, in this case, water is eliminated. You see this OH here reacting with this H. H plus AOH will give us what? H2O as one of the product first. Then when these two combine, what are you going to find? Get? You have arrow COO. Then this other arrow here attaches, you form what? Arrow. This is an ester and this is water. So this kind of reaction is an esterification reaction. Okay, it's the formation of ester when carboxylic acid react with what? Alcohol. This is acid, carboxylic acid, and this is alcohol. Now this functional group here is what? Ester. That is why they call it esterification. Okay, esterification. So the correct answer to this question is what? It's an esterification reaction. Let's go to the next question. The question says, which of the following statement is true? Enantiomers can be distinguished by physical and chemical method. Now, what are enantiomers? Enantiomers are non-superimposable stable mirror images. Compounds that are not superimposable mirror images of each other are enantiomers. For instance, Let's say you have a compound like this. Let's say this is hydrogen, or let's leave the examples. Let's just go through the theoretical aspect of it. Now, enantiomers can be distinguished by physical and chemical method. That is wrong. They cannot be distinguiced by physical and chemical method. Diastereoisomers cannot be distinguished. They can be distinguished by physical and chemical. Now, enantiomers are mirror images. That is the correct answer. We just saw it. That I told you, enantiomers are superimposable mirror images. Now, the isomers are mirror images. That is wrong. Diastereoisomers are non-superimposable non-mirror images. Are we getting it? They are stereoisomers that are non-superimposable, and they are also what? Non-mirror images. Do we get that perfect now? So that is the correct answer to that question. Now the next. Which of the following is true about hybridization? Now, the number of atomic orbitals must be equal to the number of molecular orbitals. That is very, very correct. We said in hybridization, the atomic orbitals that miss must be equal to the what? The molecular orbital that is formed. And that is the right answer to that question. The number of atomic orbital must be equal to the number of molecular orbital. Hybridization is the missing of molecular. That is wrong. Hybridization is the missing of what? Atomic orbital to form molecular orbital. Sigma overlap enhances reactivity of a compound. That is wrong. Pi overlap enhances reactivity. Okay, so that is the answer to that question. Now let's continue. Which of the following is true about the type of hybridization? The S character in sp3 is 25%. Is that correct? Now sp3 is what? sp3. How many atoms are there? You have S, P, P, P. Now, how many S are here? 1. How many P's are here? 4. So 1 over 4 times 100%. When this cancels this, what are you going to have? 25%. So you see that in sp3, the S character is 25%. Now, what of sp2? What is the S character? Now, in sp2, how many atoms we have? We have S, P, P as sp2. Now, how many atoms in total are here? There are 3. How many S's are there? 1 times 100%. When this cancels this, what are we going to have? We have the 3.3%. Okay? And that is the answer to that question. So this one is 33.3, not 25%. Now the S character in SP. How many atoms are in SP? 2. How many S's? 1. How many atoms? 2 times 100%. And this will give us 50%. Okay, so this supposed to be 50%, and this 33.3%. So that makes option A the only correct answer to that question. Now, all of the following are true about crystallization except hot concentrated solution is cold. That is true. Crystallization is a technique whereby it varies in the solubility at different temperature. When the solution is hot, the substance is stable in it. For instance, let's say you have this as a solvent. Okay, let's say this is your solvent and you have this. Now when this thing is hot and is bringing out fumes, this thing is what is soluble. What is the soluble? But once it's no longer cool, sorry about that, once it's no longer cold, what happens to it? Once it's no longer hot, rather, what happened to it? It will not form crystal. Are you getting this now? To now form crystal. So water crystallization is formed. That is true. Saturation of solution is not required. The solution must be what? Saturated. That is not correct. Crystals are formed. That is true. So in crystallization, everything I cycled are correct except number C. And hence, number C is the correct answer to this question. Now the next. The product of the reaction between this. Now when benzene is hydrogenated in the presence of running nickel as a catalyst, what will happen? It becomes what? Saturated hydrocarbon. That means each of these bonds will be what? Broken. And the product of that reaction will give us a ring without a bond. And this is called cyclohexane. So whenever benzene is hydrogenated, this is benzene ring. The product is usually what? Cyclohexane. Cyclohexane. Okay. Now you see that there are three molecules of hydrogen that reacted here. Each of the three molecule goes to break each of the what? The double bond. Are we getting it now? Every molecule contains how many hydrogen? Two hydrogen. So this one is one molecule of hydrogen breaking this double bond. This is another molecule breaking this double bond. And this another molecule breaking this double bond. So whenever benzene is hydrogenated, the product is what? Is an alkene, which is cyclohexane. Now let's go to the next question. The next question says, the name of the following compound is... Now this is a very tough one, but then we are going to provide the solution to it. Now what is the longest continuous chain? Of course we know the longest continuous chain is the straight chain. Now another thing is, where are we going to number from? If you number from here, here will be what? 1, here will be 2, here will be 3, here will be 4. You get to the first substituent at position 4. If you number from here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You get to this first substituent at position number what? 5. So it's better we number from this side. So this will be 4, and here will be what? 5, here will be 6, here will be 7, here will be 8, and here will be 9. Now, have we gotten this? The next thing is to name our substituents. Now what substituent is this? This is a carbon here, this is a carbon here. This substituent here is called ethyl. It's called what? Ethyl. Okay? That is called ethyl. So, what would be the name of this compound? This substituent here, what do you think would be the name? Now if I should bring this substituent out, it's something like this. Now you agree with me that there's a carbon here, and then there are two methyl group. Are we getting it now? So these two methyl group, you call them, at what position are they in this substituent? They are position number 1. For this substituent, they are position number 1. Because if you want to name this substituent, now let's say this one is out from this place. If you want to name this substituent, this will be carbon 1, and this will be what? The last carbon. So this carbon here, which is 1, here is what? 2. At position 1, there are two methyl groups, so you call it 1, comma. Okay? So you call it 1, comma, 1, dot, di, methyl. Then the substituent is 1, 2, ethyl. This is why we are calling it ethyl, is because it is also a substituent. Like a substituent carrying another substituent. This is 1, 1, dimethyl ethyl. So, which of them are we going to name first? Is it the 5 or the other one? So, let's name the 5 ethyl first. So, the name of this compound will be what? 5 ethyl. They will have 4. Are we getting it? Brackets. Because at position number 4, you have this substituent. You are now going to write this substituent, which is 1, 1 dimethyl. Are you getting it now? Then nonane. Nonane is how many? 6. Nonane is 6. And that will be the name of this compound. 5 ethyl, 4 bracket 1, 1 dimethyl nonane. And that is option A for this particular question. Or, okay, maybe there's something I want to correct here. Let me check if I didn't type this particular place where. In the options, there is 4 here. Please take note, because I know that the di will definitely come first. Between the dimethyl and E, which one comes first? Di comes before what? E. Okay, guys, like I was saying, that for this particular case, this will not be the answer. I will explain why. What is wrong with this stuff? Okay, I will explain why. Now, when you see this compound given to you like this, you say this is 1,1-dimethyl ethyl, and this is what ethyl. You are going to look the dimethyl and the ethyl. Which one comes first? D came before what? E. So you name the dimethyl first. At what position is the dimethyl? It's at position number 4. So this becomes 4, what? 1,1-dimethyl. Dimethyl, what? Ethyl. 5-ethyl nonane. Why is it 5-ethyl nonane? Because the ethyl group is at position number what? 5. Okay, the ethyl group is at position number 5. So you say 5-ethyl. The 1,1-dimethyl ethyl, which is this one, is at position number 4. That is why we say it is 4. So the correct answer to this question is this, which is this answer, not this one. Okay, this one is wrong. This one is wrong. The correct answer is this. So that is the answer to that question. Let's go to the next. The next question says, the following are true about homolytic cleavage of bond except. Now we said in homolytic cleavage, let's say these two electrons cleave. What happens? Each of the atoms will go home with an electron, and this electron, we call them free radicals. Okay, free radicals. So now you have your first option, radicals are formed. That is true. Reaction involving homolytic fissures are catalyzed by light. That is true. Nonpolar solvent enhances homolytic fission. That is true. Then ion pairs are formed. That is false. Nonpolar solvent enhances homolytic fission. Okay, now let's go to the next question. The following are permanent effect except. The following are permanent. Every other effect here are permanent except what? Endotomeric. Are we getting it? Endotomeric is not a permanent effect. It's a temporary effect. Endotomeric is not a permanent effect. It's what? Temporary. Let me say it again. Endotomeric is not a permanent effect. It is what? Temporary. This one, mesomeric, inductive, and hyperconjugation are our permanent effect. Now, the hyperconjugable hydrogen atom in this compound is Now, the hyperconjugable are the ones that are closest to the what? To the carbon bearing the double bond from either side. Now, this is the point where the double bond is. Every hydrogen attached to any carbon at this point are hyperconjugable. So this one is hyperconjugable. We have three hydrogens here, because this is a carbon bonded to here. This one also is a carbon bonded to this carbon. Okay, the hydrogens here are three. This one also, the hydrogens here are what? Three. So in total, if we have three plus three from here plus three from here, making it to be how many? 9. So the number of hyperconjugable hydrogen is how many? Is 9. Do you understand the fact now? So this is 9 hyperconjugable hydrogen. So the first point is take your point of conjugation, which is your double bond. Then after double bond, single bond, this is conjugable. So the three hydrogens here are 1. You call them 3. Then this is the double bond. After double bond, single, this is conjugable. Hydrogens here, you write it. And also this one here, you write it. So in total, we have 9 hyperconjugable hydrogen. Now the next. Which of the following are correct? Alcohol exhibits conformational isomerism. That is wrong. Alkenes undergoes conformational isomerism. That is wrong. Alkynes, wrong. The only compound that undergoes conformational isomerism is what? Alkenes. Alkenes undergoes conformational isomerism. Okay. The number of pi electrons in benzene is what? This is benzene structure. Pi electrons are formed from pi bond. Now, how many bonds are here? How many pi bonds are here? There's a pi bond, and another pi bond. So we have a total of how many pi bonds? 3 pi bonds. Now, note that one bond has how many electrons? 2 electrons. One bond has how many electrons? 2 electrons. So therefore, the three bonds, 3 pi bond, we have a total of how many electrons? 6 electrons. If one has 2 electrons, 3, we have what? 6. And that makes this the correct answer to that question. Okay? Now, which of the following is not a ketone? Which of the following is not a ketone? Now, all of them here, if you draw their structure, they are ketones, except this. Now, why is it except this? If I should draw this one, this is CH3, right? They will have C double bond O, what? H. That is the meaning of what you have here, CH3, C, O. This oxygen is usually double bonded, okay? The double bond O, then what? H. This is an aldehyde. We say the aldehydes, they have the general formula of what? RO, C, double bond O, and H. So this is an aldehyde, and these other ones are ketone. Let's take this one for instance. This is CH3, C double bond O, CH3. This is ketone. Okay? Same thing applicable here. This is CH3, C double bond O, CH2, CH3. This contains an arrow group, C double bond O, and another word, arrow group. So this is a ketone. Also, if you draw for this, it's also a ketone. So the correct answer, the one that is not a ketone, is option D. And that makes option D the correct answer to that question. Now, the next. Alkanes are not very reactive because they have sigma electrons only, lone pairs of electrons only, double pairs of electrons only. They have no pi electrons. They are not very reactive because they have no pi what electrons. They don't have pi electrons. But this question is somehow confusing. They have no pi electrons. They have only sigma electrons. That is a reason why they are not also reactive. They have only sigma. But the most important thing is that they have no pi electrons. Okay? Have no pi electrons. Now, let's continue. Which is not a concept for defining acid and bases? Wohler, Lewis, Brustolores, and Arrhenius. We have three concepts of defining acid. The Lewis acid, Brustolores acid and base, and the Arrhenius acid and base. Wohler is not a concept for defining acid, and hence option A is the correct answer. Wohler is not a concept for defining acid. Let's go to the next. The total number of pi bonds found in the following compound is. Now, wherever you see a double bond, one of that bond is sigma and the other is pi. Wherever you see a triple, one is sigma and then two are pi bond. Now you are asked to find total number of pi bond. Now in this triple bond here, two are pi and then one is what? Sigma. Okay? Now in this double bond here, one is pi and the other one is what? Sigma. Here, one is sigma and the other one is what? Pi. Okay? So we say wherever I see double bond, one is sigma, one is pi. Wherever you see triple bond, one is sigma, two are pi. So in total, now how many pi bonds are here? You have 2 pi plus what? Pi. Because this pi. In total, how many pi bonds? 4 pi bond. So the total number of pi bonds here is how many? Is 4. And that makes sense as a correct answer to that question. Now, you have a question before you. What is the IUPAC name of the following compound? First of all, note that while numbering, in a case like this, while numbering, the alkene should be numbered first, then, but the alkyne should be named last. But the alkene should be numbered first. So this one be what? Number one. Here will be what? Two. Here will be what? Three. One, two, three, four. Do you know why? Because the alkene and the alkyne, they have almost similar priority. So from which side are we going to number from that we get to this substituent? Or which of them are we going to number that we get to the functional group? If we number from this side, this is one, two. You go to this group as carbon number two. Number from this side, you have one. So this one should be what? should be numbered first. Are we getting it now? So here becomes 1, here is what, 2, here is 3, here is 4, here is 5, and here is what, 6. Okay, so your naming, you name the akin first, because the akin, the akin, the name E comes before what? And the akin, they have the highest priority in this case. So you name the akin first. So this becomes, at what position do you have the substituent? So position number 3. So this becomes 3 meets I. Now what is the longest continuous chain? Is has. Then the akin group is at position 1. So you say has 1 in the what? 4 iron. Has 1 in 4 iron. Why is it 4 iron? Because the iron group, the akin group is at position number 4. And that means option D, correct answer. 3 meter has 1 in 4 iron. Okay? So I believe basically that this will be the end of our class for today. In our next class, we are going to treat more questions, more organic chemistry questions. If you like this video, please turn on your notification button and give it a thumbs up. Thank you for your time.